Hey, welcome back. So today I wanted to make a new type of video, a video essay of sorts. And with Spider-Man destroying the box office, I thought what better video to make than this one. Here's how Spider-Man No Way Home saved Tom Holland's Spider-Man in the MCU. I'm the first one to admit that I'm a Spider-Man fanboy. Ever since I was 4 years old watching Toby swing through New York, I was hooked on the character. I enjoyed every rendition of him. Even adamantly defended Andrew Garfield in his movies against the haters. But ever since Tom took up the mantle, things just didn't feel the same. I found myself leaving the theater for Homecoming and Far From Home in a much different way than I did for any other Spider-Man film, almost dissatisfied. At first I thought it was the nostalgia factor. Nothing really hits the same when you're older as it did when you were a kid, and I was ready to accept that reality. Almost. See, the deeper I dove into these MCU films, the more I realized that each one had a formula for success that was largely the same. As a result of Marvel Universe being so big, it was clear to me that the individual character would suffer from Marvel trying to paint a bigger picture. Whereas with Tobey and Andrew, we could focus on just being present with this one Spider-Man character and his foes. In Marvel, we've had to deal with Iron Man, Nick Fury, Doctor Strange, and not to mention the rest of the Avengers. It took the focus off what I cared about most, the character I loved and came to see, Spider-Man. This is why Spider-Man Homecoming, to me, is one of the worst live-action installations of Spider-Man that we have gotten, with Far From Home not much better. The movies seem less about Peter Parker and more about how the story can tie into the next MCU project. Adding on to that, Peter has no consequences for his actions. When he falls into the lake, Iron Man comes and saves him. When he fails on the ferry, Iron Man again saves the day, and when he crash lands billions of dollars of Stark Tech, he's rewarded not only with his suit back, but also a slot in the Avengers. Compare that to Toby and Andrew feeling the gut-wrenching pain of causing their uncle's deaths and wanting vengeance for it, or Toby's loss of losing Harry both before and after his death, or even Andrew losing Gwen, his whole heart. Their actions had true consequences, and proved that truly, with great power comes great responsibility. Tom's Spider-Man's stakes in the first two films simply did not equate to his predecessors. Peter never truly grew because he always had someone to fix things for him, and no real loss which made him weaker and almost broke him, only for him to fight through it and become stronger. Which is why No Way Home finally delivered for me. No Way Home finally felt like a Spider-Man film for me. It focused on Peter, and only Peter. Not only did he suffer great loss with his aunt dying, but he suffered because he was trying to do the right thing. This was all his fault, and for the first time ever, it seemed like no one was going to be there to help him, except himself, all three of him. I loved seeing Toby and Andrew in this film, not just because it's a fan service and I grew up idolizing these characters, but because they actually fit. They're further along their arcs as Peter Parker, and showed Tom's Peter that there is hope, without doing it all for him. They didn't take over the movie as equals to Tom's character, but coaxed him in the right path, in the right direction, in the end. I also want to talk about the villains in this film, and the villains from Tom's first two films. I think Michael Keaton did a great job as Vulture, but I don't believe the Vulture character was written very well. Spider-Man villains are supposed to be lost souls, not bad people. As Flint Marko, the Sandman, said in Spider-Man 3, "I'm not a bad person, I just had bad luck." While I understand Vulture was getting stood up by larger corporations, I just feel like he was never a good person, and was always destined to be the bad guy for Spider-Man to have to take on. There's no real weight to his character, and I never catch myself feeling bad for him, or wishing he wasn't so down on his luck. Compare that to Tobey's Green Goblin or Doc Ock, and it's an entirely different story. Norman Osborn was such a good man who loved Peter, and was willing to help him. Every time I go back and watch that movie, I create a scenario in my head hoping he doesn't take the serum. Just like how every time I watch Spider-Man 2, I want Doc Ock's reactor to work, and for his wife to survive. These are how villains are supposed to be written. Any good villain is created, not born, and this is what separates the first two Spider-Men from Tom. We feel bad for Green Goblin, Doc Ock, Sandman, the Lizard, and Electro. You can't tell me you feel the same pain for Vulture or Mysterio. Yet again, this is where No Way Home delivered for me, because in this movie, the villains were not evil. Instead, they appeared lost, confused, even a little bit human. Each one simply wanted to live and safely go back to where they came from. It was almost as if Peter was the villain of the first half of the film, subjecting these lost souls to a new universe they had no business being in. I found myself feeling for the villains and hoping they'd return safely. I was almost mad at Peter. When Doctor Strange talked about their fates being that they had to die, I was hoping Peter would fight him for their survival and protect them. Being able to make an audience root against their heroes in favor of villains is not an easy thing to do, but it makes the movie that much better for me. Having that inner conflict as a viewer allows us to tap into the characters' minds and understand what they must be going through. What would I do if I were Peter? Now that is filmmaking. Another thing these villains, Willem Dafoe's Green Goblin in particular, did beautifully was challenge Peter, not just physically, but psychologically. Spider-Man can always punch his way out of things and use his strength to win battles. He should always be challenged mentally though, and his villains should always be able to bring out the worst in him. Similar to Batman and the Joker, the Green Goblin is a perfect example of that. He makes calculated decisions to lead Peter to dive off the deep end, trying to corrupt him. You see, the Green Goblin is essentially the same as Spider-Man. Both suffered unfortunate complications by laboratory experiments, but one used his power to help people, and another used it to take what he wanted. Green Goblin is always trying to get Spider-Man to use his power in reckless ways and make him lose
the same way he did.
Corrupting the people's hero, the best of us, is the most devastating blow a villain can deliver. And he almost succeeds. Toby coming in to stop Tom from finishing the Green Goblin with his own glider is probably my favorite part in the entire movie. Not only did it perfectly encompass Toby's character arc and show us how far he's come as an older Peter Parker, but it showed Tom that he is above that as well. He is the best of us, and he can and will persevere through. That mentorship was just such a cool moment for me, and that was the perfect Peter Parker moment. Overall, this film saved Spider-Man and the MCU for me. Whereas the other two films were watered down and more Avengers-oriented, this one was bar none Tom's story about coming of age as Peter Parker. His character had finally grown into what we can expect from Peter, an underdog who is tempted to do things he shouldn't through pain and loss, but still finds a way to take the high road and do the right thing. This inner conflict has always been my favorite thing about the character, because it's the same thing all of us go through every single day. It made Peter Parker relatable to where I felt he's just someone like me. If you enjoyed this video, please leave a comment down below about what you would like me to do an essay on next. I really value you guys' input. And remember, drop a like and subscribe if you are new. And I hope you guys all have a wonderful day. Peace.